Thank you. That ends the statement from the Deputy First Minister. I apologise to the two members I couldn't call. The next item of business is a debate on motion number 14791 in the name of Hugh Henry on women and social security.
Thank you very much. And as the presiding officer said, the next item of business is a debate on motion number 14791 in the name of Hugh Henry on women and social security. And I now call on Claire Adamson to speak to and move the motion in the name of Hugh Henry on behalf of the Welfare Reform Committee. Ms. Adamson, you have 13 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, presiding officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak to you today in order to share the conclusions and recommendations of the Welfare Reform Committee's recent inquiry, Women and Social Security. The committee reported that the cumulative impact of the reforms to the social security system has had a damaging and disproportionate impact on women. In particular, disabled women, lone parents, carers, refugee women and those experiencing domestic abuse. The cumulative effect not only negatively impacts on the women's lives, but on that of their families and the people they care for. While the committee welcomed the reports that there are more women in work than ever before, you cannot escape the fact that £26 billion worth of cuts have been made to the benefits and tax credits, pay and pensions since 2010. And according to the House of Commons Library, 85% of this £26 billion has been taken from women's incomes. The committee heard that one of the reasons for the disproportionate impact is an existing systemic inequality for women. This inequality has been aggravated by the recent reforms to the social security system. I'm sure that the whole chamber is aware of the challenges that women face finding accessible and good quality childcare. We also heard about women being forced into lower level, pink collar jobs, women earning less in the workplace, and the over-reliance on women as primary carers. This can impact people over a lifetime. It means, for instance, women have fewer financial assets and less access to occupational pensions than men. Women are twice as likely to give up paid work in order to care, and 92% of lone parents are women. Overall, it is clear to see why women are twice as dependent on the social security system than men. I'd like to thank the committee members, the clerking team, and all those who contributed to the report during our deliberations. The committee published the report Women and Social Security in July of this year, based on the written and oral evidence received from the committee, and it made a number of conclusions and recommendations. Can I thank the committee member, Christina McElvey, in particular for suggesting that the committee take this approach in our deliberations. I may not be able to cover each and all of the recommendations, but what I want to do is give a flavour of our main findings, with the caveat that a Conservative member of the committee noted their dissent from certain conclusions and recommendations, and this is detailed in the report. So if we look at some of the main changes, if I can start with universal credit. One of the biggest reforms, which is still in the rollout phase, is universal credit. The principles behind it can be seen as laudable. Making it easier for everyone to gain and sustain employment should be a good thing. However, we as a committee heard evidence that the financial arrangements for second earners, who are most likely to be women, may discourage them from entering the labour market at all. That is why we called on the UK government to rethink the earnings disregard for second earners to make work more financially worthwhile for the second earners, who are mainly women. The committee welcomed the proposals to allow Scotland discretion over its administrative elements. And we would like to see the Scottish Government use the powers to make a move away from monthly payments and single household payments to allow women to budget more effectively and preserve their financial autonomy within the household. The committee would also like to see a return of direct housing payments direct to the landlord. Being able to choose what is best for you and your family and decrease the risk of rent arrears will improve women's security and the ability to provide for their children. When we turn to employment and job-seeking support, working women will need a new social security system which will overcome the barriers which prevent or restrict their labour market participation. For it to be its most effective, we believe that job-seeking support should be integrated across health, housing and social care and tailored to meet the needs of particular groups. The committee would like the Scottish Government to think about how it can incentivise employers to provide true flexible working arrangements for women with caring responsibilities and also reduce the dependence on short-term and zero-hours contracts. The committee recognised the work done in Scotland so far in increasing child provision. However, more could be done, and efforts to improve the availability, quality and flexibility of childcare should allow women to return to work if that is their wish and should continue to be a top priority. We also examined the impact on lone parents. We heard that the system creates pressures, especially on lone parents, to apply for or take up work that does not fit in with their caring responsibilities. To avoid this pressure, we want the DWP to make job centres more welcoming and appropriately train staff and provide experts with specialist knowledge for particular circumstances. Especially since the announcement of the emergency budget earlier this year, that from April 2017, parents claiming universal credit, including lone parents, will be expected to prepare for work from when their youngest child turns two and to look for work when their youngest child turns three. We need to make sure that existing safeguards for lone parents are working to avoid single mothers being threatened or receiving sanctions inappropriately, which brings me to the S word and one of our areas of great concern, sanctions. The committee has always taken a strong view on the impact of sanctions and in all the necessity of some form of conditionality is welcomed and understood by the committee. We believe that the current operation of the so-called sanctions regime can be punishing and counterproductive. So the committee will continue to demand of the DWP a review on the application of its policies at a local level to ensure that sanctions are only ever a last resort. We have also joined a voice with the UK Parliament's Work and Pension Committee to call on the UK Government to conduct a comprehensive, independent review on sanctions to identify whether they are actually having their desired effect at all, which should be to encourage people into work. In addition, we want to see the UK Government publish a tracking study to follow the true cost of being sanctioned and how this impacts, not just on the immediate finances of the claimant, but the knock-on effect on local authority services and the subsector and the NHS. The committee also took evidence on the impact on women experiencing domestic violence. Talking about the true costs of reform, we need to consider the knock-on impact on all particular groups. Women experiencing domestic and financial abuse have suffered a decrease in their financial autonomy, increasing the risk of remaining or returning to an abuser. We found that this can be a particular issue for European Economic Area job seekers, where their right to reside is based on their partner's status. The UK government should consider what further security and protection it can offer women who wish to leave abusive partners. And we want to see the DWP promoting its domestic violent easement flexibilities to remove the job-seeking pressures on women exiting abusive relationships. The committee also examined the impact on refugee women. The danger of a lack of financial autonomy is also something particularly experienced by refugee women. We heard that women in the household may not receive a national insurance number for several weeks, and in some occasions don't receive their national insurance number without significant advocacy work on behalf of the third sector or of an elected member. And this can leave them destitute, with no rights to claim benefits in their own name and potentially no bank account or financial independence. We have highlighted these issues to the UK Government in order for it to do more to speed up the process and give these women the right to their own financial autonomy. This week we heard of some of the impacts of the sanctions regime and work capability assessments on people with mental health issues. At the time of writing the report, we had looked at this issue and we'd heard about the disproportionate impact of the reforms on women. This understandably does have serious impact on people with mental health issues going through this process. NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde cited evidence that compared to men, women in their area have significantly poorer mental health profiles. They argued that loss of income and stigma through sanctioning or changes in benefits are very large risk factors in triggering mental health problems and suicide. This is why the committee was shocked when witnesses told us that the recent tightening of eligibility criteria in employment support allowance discriminates against women with mental health issues. The new screening system places additional requirements on women to prove they are at a higher risk of self-harm or suicide than men undergoing the same assessment. So not only is the impact of the cuts disproportionately felt by women, women having to go to disproportionate lengths in which to prove the negative impact on their mental health. The committee has written to the UK Minister to try to understand why they have put in place such potentially discriminatory policies. We also looked at the impact on carers and children of the social security reforms. And of course, these negative impacts are not only felt by the women involved, it would be keenly felt by the people from whom they care. We know that 74% of those in receipt of carers' allowance are women. These women make an essential contribution to our society in these caring roles. And we heard about the significant challenges many carers face when they take on a caring role. They often see a sharp rise in household expenditure, accompanied by a drop in income, as earnings disregard is so low that can act as a disincentive to work. That's why the committee supports the Scottish Government proposal to bring carers' allowance into line with job seekers' allowance. The committee also believes that there should be a stronger link between the social security system and the Scottish Government's approach to child poverty and to getting it right for every child. And we encourage the Scottish Government to consider these links when planning the delivery of devolved benefits. So for the future of social security in Scotland, now the potential for Scotland to use the proposed devolved powers over benefits is an interesting and challenging proposal.
1 minute.
We as a committee welcome the devolution of further social security powers to Scotland, and this can be our opportunity to rectify some of the systematic inequalities that women face to reverse some of this disproportional impact. When taking our opportunity to design the new system, we want us to see the Scottish Government embedding gender and human rights analysis throughout the whole further devolution process. We need to examine our services and better support those in need, and we need to get this right for the women of Scotland. In order to do this, we want to see a dedicated action plan from the Scottish Government to mitigate the impact of social security cuts on women. And this plan should take stock of employability services, social care and childcare provision. And Presiding Officer, I'm out of time, so I look forward to hearing the contributions this afternoon from the Chamber.
Many thanks. We are tight for time today. Now call on Margaret Burgess. 9 minutes, please, Minister.
Okay. Presiding Officer, I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate. Achieving real, meaningful gender equality is right at the heart of this Government's core objectives. We are absolutely committed to ensuring that equality of opportunity is embedded in everything that we do. And first of all, I would like to thank the Welfare Reform Committee and those who gave evidence to inform the findings of this report. It's a comprehensive report and it makes for interesting, if disturbing, reading. I recollect that there were a number of thoughtful submissions made through the call for evidence that gave some quite compelling insights into the issues women are facing through the benefits regime. and the Cabinet Secretary has already published the Government's response to the recommendations of the report. There is much that we're already taking forward in the issues identified, but unfortunately there's also much that demonstrates why so many of us wanted full devolution of Social Security. But rest assured, this Government will continue to make the case to the UK Government that its austerity regime is punishing some of our most vulnerable people. The Chancellor's U-turn on tax credits shows that the Scottish Government was right to keep up the continued and constant pressure right up till the last minute, highlighting the damage that would be inflicted by changing the tax credit system and calling on George Osborne to reverse his proposal, as the changes would have had a devastating impact on the incomes of thousands of low-paid families, which is something the Scottish Government consistently said. So while I welcome the capitulation of the Chancellor on tax credits, the Tories' ideological-driven austerity agenda is still in course. Because make no mistake, the cuts are still coming. There will still be £12 billion worth of cuts to the welfare budget over the next 5 years, around £1 million of which will be land and low-income families and individuals in Scotland. But I want to touch on some of the specific recommendations made in the report and some of the action the Scottish Government is taking to address them. Our analysts estimate that the cumulative impact of welfare cuts in Scotland is some £6 billion. This year alone, there will be cuts of just under £2.5 billion here in Scotland. And that demonstrates the scale of the challenge we face, as the Women and Social Security report made clear. On disability and the impact of welfare cuts in disabled women, we absolutely agree with the committee on the importance of maintaining the existing budget. That's why the fiscal framework is so important in the negotiations between the Scottish Government and the UK Government. And I would hope, as John Swinney said earlier, that across this chamber we can unite to ensure that the transfer of powers comes with the full budget. We have invested nearly £300 million over 3 years in welfare mitigation funding, from fully mitigating the bedroom tax to providing funding for food banks. We have taken a range of actions to shelter people from the worst of the Tories' damaging welfare policies. So, Presiding Officer, we are already using the powers that we have to improve outcomes, and we now also, as Claire Adamson said, have an opportunity through the new powers to make progress in providing a quality of service that is more joined up and also delivers a better service for women. The committee, like the Scottish Government, have heard a wealth of evidence and issues to do with disabilities assessment. And I can say to the Parliament that we are absolutely committed to ensuring a Scottish social security system will have at its heart a set of principles and values. This will include ensuring people are treated with respect and dignity when applying for, being assessed for, and receiving disability-related benefits. We will also ensure people are provided with the relevant information so that they are aware of how the system will work for them and how long decisions will take. And we will ensure it's a fair and efficient system, but importantly, a person-centred system. And that's how people will regain their trust in social security. The Scottish Government has already announced measures that will help women who are often carers. Earlier in the autumn, we announced we will abolish the UK Government 84-day rule, which means families who face higher living costs due to their child's illness or disability will not be penalised when their child goes into hospital or has necessary medical treatment. We've also said, as Claire Adamson alluded to, that carers will be placed at the heart of the devolved carers allowance and will begin to increase the rate of the allowance to that of job seekers allowance. There were a number of recommendations in the committee's report made in relation to universal credit flexibilities, and we welcome some of the flexibilities given through the Scotland Bill and have already stated our commitment to using these flexibilities to allow households to request we pay social landlords direct for rent payments and to move away from monthly payments. And I know that many organisations working with vulnerable women also want to see a split payment option, and we're listening carefully to those points and will monitor how this could work in practice when universal credit is ruled out fully. Presiding Officer, the report touched on the issue of women in low-paid work and employment, and progress is being made across a range of areas, The female employment rate in Scotland is 71.1%, above the UK rate of 69%. And according to Skills Development Scotland, figures on the number of female modern apprentices has increased from 27% in 2008-09 to 40% in 2014-15. Female learners also outnumber males at college when measured in both headcount and full-time equivalent. And more encouraging still, the number of women studying full-time courses has increased 15% since 2006-07. The gender pay gap is lower in Scotland than the rest of the United Kingdom, but there's still much more that can be done. As part of the delivery of our economic strategy, we've established a Fair Work Convention and launched the Scottish Business Pledge. These will all help to make a meaningful difference to ensuring appropriate representation of all women in the workplace. The report recognised the difficulties women face in going back to work and in caring responsibilities, and the Scottish Government is committed to supporting and helping to deliver family-friendly, flexible working in Scotland. One step the Scottish Government is taking is to increase the provision of childcare to improve outcomes for children and support more women back into work. And by the end of next Parliament, we will double the hours from 16 to 30, and we will also look at having flexible hours for childcare. We acknowledge the committee's recommendation that the employment programme support should include a tailored English language support for refugees, and I think that that is important, particularly for women. There is a recognition that women lose out because they don't children can learn language at school. Men are maybe out working, and various difficulties we had with the national insurance number make it more difficult for women. And we've taken that on board with our current refugee programme and the package that local authorities are building up for the refugees that we're taking in from the Syrian crisis, to ensure that English language is very much at the heart of that, and women are very much included in that. I want to say a bit here also about, as Claire Adamson called it, the S word. It is a matter of genuine regret to me that conditionality and the benefits sanction wasn't devolved as part of the Smith settlement. We continue to believe the sanction system is harsh and pushes people into crisis. It's clear it needs wholesale reform, and we remain of the view that an independent review of the sanctions regime is absolutely necessary. So in closing this today, I would like to thank again the Welfare Reform Committee and welcome the report and today's date. The Scottish Government fully recognises the disproportionate impact of the UK Government's welfare changes have had on women and children. And in our own engagement, we've worked closely with women's groups to ensure we have an understanding of the issues faced. New powers in social security and employment do provide us with an opportunity to have a Scottish social security system that is delivering for women. And, Presiding Officer, be assured that this Government will do everything we can to make the most of that opportunity.
Many thanks. Many buttons still to be pressed for those wishing to speak in this debate. Now call on Jenny Mara. 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by thanking the committee for this wide-ranging and authoritative report on the issues impacting women from welfare reform. It strikes me that had the UK Government shown the same attention to the impact of its reforms, they may not have been so gleeful and gung-ho in pursuing the deep cuts to social security, which will be felt by mothers, grandmothers, carers, low-paid workers, lone parents, by victims of domestic abuse, by refugee women, by women suffering mental health problems, by disabled women and, of course, children. All of this potential damage, often with multiple impacts on women, has been covered forensically and compassionately by the authors of this report here in Parliament. It is indeed, Presiding Officer, a damning indictment of the welfare policies of the UK Government and the lack of regard for women who need social security to support their families. Of course, this is not the whole story. Two important developments have emerged since the good work of the Welfare Reform Committee. Just a day after this report was published in July, the Chancellor returned to the House of Commons with his emergency budget. He announced £34 billion worth of additional cuts. and the House of Commons Library estimated that 70% of these cuts will fall on women. We have yet to see whether the spending review yesterday will ameliorate or exacerbate this unfair targeting of women. So instead of using his new mandate to reduce the structural inequalities that have held so many women back, the Chancellor has taken the decision to reinforce them. The Tory cry that we are all in this together has never seemed so hollow, and it will not be recognised by women across the United Kingdom. The women of Scotland fearing those cuts have been given some hope in other developments since the Chancellor deepened his welfare cuts, however. The emergence of the Scotland Bill as a considerable transfer of powers from Westminster to Holyrood gives all of us who oppose these unfair welfare cuts an opportunity to do something about it. The top-up powers over welfare and the devolution of income tax mean that we can now match our rhetoric with action and design a fairer social security system that protects women. Yes, the Scottish Government already has considerable influence over issues relating to equality, and the Welfare Reform Committee rightly points out several areas which need to be improved here and now. And to his credit, the Cabinet Secretary has given the committee a very full response on behalf of the Scottish Government, which details some of the action being taken to support women adversely affected by welfare reform. But the real prize, presiding officer, will be how the next Scottish Government and this Parliament use the new powers over welfare to correct the wrong-headed approach by the Tory Government for the women of Scotland. A good start, I think, would be for the Scottish Government to take the suggestion of the Welfare Reform Committee and call a high-level summit on women's social security, as supported by Engender, Scottish Women's Aid, Scottish Refugee Council and Close the Gap. This would allow us to determine what strategic action is needed to redress the gender impact of welfare reform and public spending cuts, and I hope the Minister might address this suggestion in her closing remarks this afternoon. As this report outlines, there is much work to do, and the situation continues to escalate. Yesterday, the Chancellor of the Exchequer performed a spectacular and welcome U-turn on tax credits that will mean many working people are spared these unfair cuts. He also spared the blushes of the SNP, who had failed miserably to show any real appetite for reversing the proposed tax credit cuts when the powers come to Scotland, when we debated this here in this chamber 2 weeks ago. Yes.
Mason.
I thank the member for giving way. I mean, does she think that Labour really got its tactics right on this? Because surely the best bet was to challenge the principle before we worried about where the money would come from to compensate.
Jenny Marra.
Tell the member, my primary concern is not the tactics, but the working people who had been affected by the cuts to tax credits, and these benches miserably failed to show any appetite for wanting to use the powers that are coming to this building to mitigate or reverse those tax cuts, and that was the shame of 2 weeks ago. But I hope they will not be found wanting as we look to address what is left of the UK Government's welfare reform programme. And as we saw yesterday, it is still a substantial and pernicious agenda, and I know the Minister agrees with me on that. Scottish politics will have changed forever when the powers promised by the Smith Commission come to Holyrood. No longer will the Scottish people indulge us when we complain about cuts to the most vulnerable in society. No longer will it be enough to join in on the chorus of despair at the Tory welfare reforms, protected from the hard choices that come from power and responsibility.
Could you draw to a close, please?
The people of Scotland, indeed the women of Scotland, will instead look to us to act and use these new powers to build the fairer and more compassionate Scotland to which we aspire.
Many thanks. I now call on John Lamont. 6 minutes, please, Mr Lamont.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in today's debate and the attention that the committee has given to the relationship between policy choices and the opportunity of women. While I have little doubt that there will be some areas of fairly robust disagreement, I am pleased that there were several areas in the committee's report where agreement was found. This was reflected in the constructive contributions of my colleague and predecessor on the committee, Annabel Goldie, who will be speaking later on this afternoon. Despite the title, it is worth considering that the committee's report and recommendations go further than the direct impact of benefits. It touches upon a range of issues from the status of women in the workplace, as parents or carers, potentially as lone parents, and the interplay of benefits, employment, childcare, flexible working and a variety of other measures. That is to the committee's credit. However, I cannot shake the feeling that some of the context of the changes to social security was missed. When my party came into government in 2010, there was a very reasonable view that social security spending was too high, created perverse disincentives to employment, and was extremely complex. The last Labour government, for their part, adopted a range of policies under the banner of welfare reform. The problem was that their vision was often contradictory, short-termist, and in some occasions, as with the introduction of employment and support allowance and the work capability assessment, poorly implemented. I have no reservation in stating my ambition to see a lower welfare society. The best and most sustainable way to achieve that is to increase employment and financial independence. In terms of the latter, we should look forward to the twin aims of higher pay and lower tax. Across the United Kingdom, we have a record level of women in employment, with almost a million more in work since the 2010 general election. This is the benefit of an economic plan that is actually delivering. The UK's recovery, with economic growth leading with the advanced economies of the world, has been notable for being employment heavy. I'll give way to Mr. Finlay.
Neil Finlay.
A few weeks ago, his colleague Baroness Goldie was in the House of Lords voting to get rid of tax credits. Can you tell us where the Tory party's position is now? Because the Scottish Tory party wanted, apparently, to keep tax credits. So where are we on this?
John Lamont.
Well, I think the Chancellor very clearly set out the position on tax credits yesterday, and I'll leave it to him and his explanation for that rather than getting involved in reopening that issue. So when we speak of a jobs miracle, it's not an idle boast. It can be seen in our constituencies and across every corner of the country. It is also not a dry statistics, but the reality of thousands more people with the security of a regular wage coming in. Deputy Presiding Officer, we know that still today, many women are often found in low-paid, part-time and less secure employment. It is therefore welcome that we have seen the greatest growth in full-time work and that wages are growing consistently while inflation remains effectively flat. Part-time work will always afford a level of flexibility, and for many it will be a choice, but we should also be considering the level of those who are in part-time jobs and seeking full-time employment, those classed as involuntary part-time. This is why we should celebrate the considerable advances in childcare provision across the United Kingdom. All of the main parties represented in this chamber have had a hand in placing this on the agenda, albeit with a number of important differences in our respective approaches. This solid groundwork allows a widening of opportunity and aspiration for a great many women. This is not only beneficial on an individual level, but across our society. It is harnessing the skills and knowledge that have in the past been absent, often not by choice, from the labour market. The committee is, of course, right to consider where our welfare system may fall short for women. The report suggests that women have, for example, a relatively poorer experience of the work programme. While it would be essential to see more evidence of this, it is important information that should be kept in mind by the Scottish Government when crafting its replacement programmes following the passage of the Scotland Bill. We should also consider these policies that while successfully benefit, we should also consider those policies which have successfully benefited women. I've already spoken of childcare, but I would also like to consider some of the other measures in the time left to me this afternoon. The increase in the personal allowance this year has taken a further 430,000 people across the United Kingdom out of paying income tax altogether, two-thirds of which will be women. The national living wage, announced by the Chancellor in the summer budget, will directly increase the income of around 3 in every 10 working women. This is not only a pay rise, but will have a positive impact on the gender pay gap, as well as providing a great deal of support for many in part-time work. Deputy Presiding Officer, as the further powers promised in the Smith Commission are making us think seriously about the future of social security in Scotland, the committee should continue to reflect on the impact of women. We must also work to build on the many significant successes we've already seen. Thank you.
Many thanks. We now turn to the open debate. We're tight for time this afternoon, so speeches of a maximum of 6 minutes, please. Could members check that they have pressed the request to speak buttons if they wish to contribute? I call Kevin Stewart, to be followed by Michael McMahon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to thank all of the members of the committee and all those that gave evidence, because this was a pretty tough piece of work. And it was the last report that Michael McMahon carried out as convener of the committee, and I'd like to pay tribute to him for his fairness in that role. And I have to say that on the committee, over the piece, it has been rare that there has been any disagreement apart from one party. And I'll leave that at that for just now. Presiding Officer, Claire Adamson, in the opening speech, highlighted the fact that research by the House of Commons Library states that since 2010, £26 billion worth of cuts have been made to benefits, tax credits, pay and pensions. 85% of this £26 billion has been taken from women's incomes. Therefore, I find it surprising that the Tory member of the committee dissented from the following sentence. The committee believes that the cumulative impact of the reforms has had a damaging and disproportionate impact on women. How can anyone argue that it has not been a disproportionate and damaging effect in women when quite clearly research shows that 85% of these cuts has been borne by women? How can anybody say that that has not been disproportionate and damaging? We've heard that women are twice as dependent on social security as men, with 20% of women's income coming from the benefits and tax credit system compared with 10% of men's. Women have fewer financial assets and less access to occupational pensions than men, and there are considerably more women than men in the lowest income decile in the UK. 92% of lone parents are women, and women make up 95% of lone parents dependent on income support. The statistics go on and on, and quite clearly show that disproportionate impact. One of the things which hasn't been touched on yet is some of the recommendations. One of the main ones, as far as I'm concerned, was that on multiple impacts. And on page 6, para 29 of the report, it says, the committee has been struck by the complexity of women's lives in relation to the benefit system. Many don't fit neatly into one administrative box and will be hit by reforms to carers, disability and children's benefits. The committee calls on the UK government to urgently conduct a cumulative impact assessment of all of the welfare reforms to identify the true impact on families and households. It is quite shocking, Presiding Officer, that that kind of assessment has not been made. And that quite clearly shows to me that the Conservative government and the previous Conservative Liberal Democrat coalition government really didn't give a monkey's about the impact of these changes that they have made. Because surely, if you're going to make that kind of major change, you want to know exactly what the impact is. Now, during his speech, Mr. Lamont says that the aspiration was to see higher pay and lower tax. And I think the Tories have achieved that in some regards, higher pay and lower tax for the most wealthy in our society, but certainly not for those folks who are struggling to make ends meet on a day and daily basis. And it comes as no surprise to me, I have to say, Presiding Officer, that that is the way that the Conservatives have moved, because that has been their attitude throughout history. Higher pay and lower tax for the rich, and really not giving a monkey's about those folks who are suffering at the and the most vulnerable and the poorest in our society. Presiding Officer, I think we only need to look at some of the statistics that have come out in recent weeks, again by the Trussell Trust, and an increase in the rise in food banks. And I have to say, during my course to visit some food banks, what you always see is women there with young kids. It is horrific that people in work are having to rely on food banks. And while I welcome the U-turn yesterday on tax credits, what we all have to remember is that for months, families in this country have been living in fear at the thought yes. of losing those tax credits. Living in fear, Presiding Officer, and I believe that that is unacceptable. If nothing else, I think we as a Parliament must ensure that that one recommendation from the committee, that cumulative impact assessment, must be carried out by the UK Government as soon as possible. They will then maybe realise the horrors of the policies that they have implemented. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I'm afraid I have to reiterate that I can only give members up to 6 minutes. Michael McMahon to be followed by Joan McAlpine.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by thanking Kevin Stewart for the very gracious comments that he made at the outset, because I was a bit concerned that I would sound conceited when I said that I felt a degree of achievement and fulfilment having been involved in generating the body of work that the Welfare Reform Committee has produced and examining the impact of the current economic climate being created by the Tory party's welfare changes. The analysis that's been undertaken by the committee on such things as the geographical and individual effect of benefit changes, the sanctions regime and the rise in food bank usage, I believe, will not only serve the Parliament well, but will serve the country well whenever these issues are discussed. However, I believe that the report we are discussing this afternoon may be the most important piece of work that the committee has so far embarked upon. The statistics concerning women's welfare issues in Scotland are staggering. The fact that women are twice as dependent on social security as men, have fewer financial assets, and make up to 95% of lone parents dependent on income support is absolutely shocking. That the gender pay gap sits at 32% for part-time workers, furthering the divide between the financial status of men and women, is embarrassing in this day and age. And these statistics lead us inescapably to the conclusion that women are disproportionately affected by social security reforms. So any unfavourable change made to the system will unavoidably be multiplied in its impact on women. For example, universal credit exists in theory to ensure that everyone in Scotland can easily retain a comfortable level of employment. However, many organisations have stated that a complete disregard for second earners in earning calculations, who are predominantly female, will have a disincentive to work as a result on the gender barriers to employment being ignored. This formula must change so that women can feel that the credit is given to them for the work that they perform. The Tory government has evidently been blissfully unaware of the needs of women in regard to social security programmes, or they just simply would not be making the changes that they are. According to the Fawcett Society, the current job-seeking support system is too crude to be able to deal with the complexities in women's lives. Job-seeking support is absolutely vital to ensure that every woman in Scotland has access to an appropriate job to her level of skill. Additionally, the impact of these policies on disabled women and those who are victims of domestic violence is utterly unacceptable. Disabled women are far less likely to obtain full-time employment than non-disabled people. In Close the Gaps estimation, that the unemployment rate for disabled men is almost 90% compared with only 40% of disabled women is an indicator that should send alarm bells ringing in many levels of authority. Discrimination and incorrectly preconceived notions about mental and physical capability are only two of the issues that women face on a day-to-day basis. A similarly shocking statistic can be found when looking at domestic abuse statistics, where 80% of cases involve a female victim. And attempting to leave an abusive partner is not only emotionally and physically challenging, but can be financially crippling. And Scottish Women Aid has noted that two-thirds of women lose their jobs due to domestic abuse-related issues. And no woman should have to fear for economic and professional well-being while experiencing a heartbreaking situation such as this. So I'd like to pay tribute in particular this afternoon to Engender, who played the pivotal role in steering the committee towards initiating this report in the first place and then taking it through its deliberations. They, more than any other group, put together a number of recommendations which would help Scotland move in the right direction on these and other issues. So first and foremost, the Scottish Government must recognise that these policies that are being introduced disproportionately impact women in all intersections of identity. Therefore, any programme proposed or put in place must be beneficial to women, with an evaluation completed as to the impact on women specifically. Job-seeking support needs to be updated to include groups of women that often face additional persecution, such as refugees, disabled women, survivors of domestic abuse, those living in rural areas, older women, lone mothers and carers. It's our duty as a legislative body to make sure that these women are given special attention, as their individualised needs are too often overlooked. Investment in employability services and job centres for women looking to get back into the labour market is simply money well spent for Scotland. Appropriate training and skilled staff with specialised knowledge should be in place to ensure that these programmes are being used as effectively and efficiently as possible. And finally, a conversation on women's welfare would be remiss without a discussion on the multiple identities many women hold. As the committee succinctly stated in the report, many women do not fit neatly into one administrative box and will be hit by reforms to carers, disability and children's benefits. A one-size-fits-all policy is not going to work for the women of Scotland, who simply deserve more than that. 51% of the Scottish population is female. It's high time that the complex needs of women as a workforce are given proper consideration to the impact of the welfare policies we produce in regards to women. Scotland now has a chance to make a real difference to these and many other issues with the new powers that we are to have. I hope that this report will be used to help guide this Parliament and others looking at this issue and future Scottish governments in the right direction. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call Joan McAlpine to be followed by Christina McKelvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wish to use the opportunity of today's debate to raise the issue of carers and those for whom they care, two groups who feature prominently in the committee's report into women and social security. They're often interdependent groups who are, of course, extremely vulnerable and who have suffered disproportionately from the cuts to social security and indeed the reduced employment opportunities caused by the economic downturn since 2008. Unpaid carers save the economy in Scotland £10.3 billion a year, and as the report documents, 59% of unpaid carers are women and 74% of those in receipt of carers allowance, which is awarded to those with the heaviest burden of caring responsibilities, are women. Women are also twice as likely as men to give up work in order to care. As one of our witnesses, Helen Graham of Napier University, pointed out, much of the differential impact of welfare reform on women, which has been well illustrated by previous speakers, stems from this unequal distribution of caring responsibilities between men and women. And, Presiding Officer, when preparing for this debate, I was reminded that in the very early days of our welfare state, indeed before Beveridge, feminists struggled in a very patriarchal society to get understanding of the huge amount of unpaid work the women did in the home and to have this recognised. And a leading suffragette and social reformer, Eleanor Rathbone, was responsible for challenging this and campaigned tirelessly to eventually secure family allowances. In order to be politically acceptable, family allowances were presented as a support for children and, of course, evolved into child benefit. But Rathbone was primarily motivated by the need to recognise the unpaid work of women in the home and the huge personal sacrifices that poor women made, neglecting their own health and well-being to prioritise those for whom they cared. The direction of welfare reforms in the 21st century suggests that we're still fighting the same battles that Eleanor Rathbone and other feminists fought almost 100 years ago to get recognition for women's unpaid work. In particular, the reforms and cuts don't adequately address the difficulties faced by those with caring responsibilities, and indeed they make life considerably more difficult for them. Care Scotland, Inclusion Scotland and individual witnesses expressed concern about the change from DLA to PIP because of a loss of financial support for the cared for person, and that has a considerable knock-on effect for the carer and for household income. Already, Presiding Officer, the financial loss in Scotland from DLA and incapacity benefit reform is estimated to be £600 million a year. When a disabled person loses their benefits, their carer could find themselves forced to claim job seekers' allowance, and this, of course, introduces conditionality and the risk of sanctions. And let's remember, Presiding Officer, that those with caring responsibilities are more likely to miss appointments, hence invoking those sanctions. And those sanctions can put the whole family into crisis, running up rent arrears, hastening eviction. They have a devastating effect on the ability not just to care, but to live with a degree of dignity. And I would say to Ms Mara that, of course, sanctions are specifically excluded from the Scotland Bill that she admires so much. Once on Job Seekers Allowance or on the work-related associated group of ESA, unpaid carers can find themselves on compulsory employability programmes, which, as Close the Gap has pointed out to committee, force women into unsuitable, gender-specific, low-paid work, often on zero-hours contracts. And those zero-hours contracts jobs often give women no opportunity to plan their life and work around the responsibility of carers. And I would point out to Ms Mara again that, of course, employability in zero-hours contracts remain reserved to Westminster. Inclusion Scotland and Close the Gap have also highlighted the particular effect that the reforms at UK level are having on women who are disabled themselves. In Scotland, 55% in those of receipt of the higher rate of mobility component of PIP are women. But we know that the DWP have a target of halving the number of DLA claimants in receipt of that higher rate mobility payment when they're reassessed for PIP, and that will have a disproportionate effect on women, particularly in Scotland. For some of the people we spoke to, the fear of losing higher rate mobility payments has caused real anxiety. Disabled women already face a number of barriers to the job market. According to Close the Gap, the employment rate for disabled men is 90% compared to 40% for disabled women. But the evidence we took suggested that that minority of disabled women who are able to work currently as a result of getting a mobility award, for example, could be further reduced because of DWP targets. Without a car or appropriate transport, they can't work. And one of our witnesses, Moira Sinclair, illustrated that absolute counterproductiveness when she spoke about how if she lost her mobility car, she would have to give up work. And the loss of income tax and national insurance would be £11,500 a year. Presiding Officer, what better illustration of how ill thought out these cuts have been? There's a higher proportion of women in Scotland claiming DLA and employment support allowance than the UK as a whole. We mustn't forget that despite these disabilities, these same women have caring responsibilities either for children or a sick partner or relative. That's why I certainly welcome the commitment from the First Minister to look at carers' allowance once it's devolved and bring it up to the level of job seekers' allowance. However, I would point out once again that only 14% of welfare in the has been devolved to Scotland under the Scotland Bill, and with £12 billion of welfare cuts still to come, we don't know where from, and I fear for women going forward. Thanks very much.
Thank you. I'm sorry that there isn't more time this afternoon, but if members take over the time, then that means someone else will lose out. Christina McKelvey to be followed by Margaret McDougall.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Welfare reform at Westminster has achieved two things.
First of all, it's deprived the most vulnerable and needy in our communities of the capacity to feed and clothe themselves without anxiety and has instead left them struggling between food bank and warm home, or sometimes any home at all. And secondly, it has aggravated an existing inequality for women. The very term welfare is popular with the Chancellor. I can't help feeling that he quite likes the Dickensian idea of the worthy poor and the magnanimity of those who offer charity, you know, that big society they talked about. But we live in the 21st century, not the 19th century, and we ought to have moved on from the workhouses and the soup kitchens. Yet the gap between rich and poor extends even wider. While international investors pour their millions into expensive houses in Kensington and Chelsea, many of my constituencies are struggling to find a few pounds to put into their gas meter. Presiding Officer, research provided to the committee by the Child Poverty Action Group and others tells us time and again that most of the people using food banks are those who are in work and have had their benefit payments sanctioned for sometimes the most absurd of reasons. And Citizens Advice Scotland told this committee of a case of a woman who was heading to the job centre when her four-year-old needed to go to the bathroom. We've all been there. If you've got kids, they want to try out every bathroom. They sanctioned her for 12 weeks for being 10 minutes late. And Bernardo's told the committee, we are aware in Scotland that the current system of benefit sanctions is nowhere near fit for purpose. Sanctions are regularly applied unfairly, leaving people with little or no money for all of long periods of time. That causes severe hardship for many claimants and can have a negative impact not only on their own health and well-being, but on their families too. And they add, when universal credit is fully rolled out, women will probably lose out even more. Women will be answerable to the male breadwinner for the money to run the house. And if he has other ideas on how to spend that money, then it will be the partners who have to try and sweep up the mess of debt, lack of food and probably a housing crisis. Citizens Advice Scotland also told the committee, and they emphasised that women use social services more than men do, and the reasons are straightforward. They tend to be the carers of children, of elderly infirm parents, of relatives with special needs, including their own children, and many are in low-paid and part-time works. They have missed out in making a prosperous career for themselves because they have put their families first. They should not be sanctioned for that. The reality is borne out by Citizens Advice Scotland, who have found that women are more likely to seek advice on housing benefit, working tax credits, child benefit and income support, and changes to these benefits are going to have a disproportionate impact on women. Housing benefit is one of the most common benefit problems that women bring to Citizens Advice Scotland. As this Scottish Government does everything it can to mitigate the horrendous impact of the bedroom tax, there are limitations upon which we are allowed to do. An East of Scotland Citizens Advice Bureau reports of a client who has a high rent arrears. She thought that she was in receipt of housing benefit, but has discovered that this support had stopped and she has working non-dependent adult children living with her. The client had arrangements in place to pay the arrears and wanted to apply for discretionary housing benefit, but was advised she can't do this if she is not in receipt of housing benefit. The complications of this system is just absolutely impenetrable. Ill health and disability payments have had a hugely damaging impact already, and it's set to get worse. PIP will make tens of thousands people who have got the right to DLA out of that system. The endless confusion, delays and backlog do nothing to support its introduction, is what Citizens Advice warned our committee during the evidence taken. The very concept that the state needs to help families on low incomes has vanished, yet pay rates are hopelessly inadequate. I believe that we have a moral and a financial duty to support people in need for whatever reason, and that they need the right framework in which to do that. I do not accept the assumption of public schoolboys in London who would never venture into a cut-price food store that we can all make a decent income and support ourselves and our families. David Cameron once said that he was born not with one, but two silver spoons in his mouth. I say try a week living in benefits in Hamilton, Lark Hall and Stonehouse. Maybe you could learn a lot. The Scottish Government rightly highlights the huge contribution made by carers, most eloquently described by my colleague Joan McAlpine and her contribution. And there's the rub. That's a part of it, isn't it? As Citizens Advice says, benefit conditionality remains reserved to the UK. The current draft of the Scotland Bill is silent on the matter, and we do not yet know the extent to which Scottish employment services may be subject to this regime. Presiding Officer, the Institute of Fiscal Studies has just reported that 2.6 million working families will be £1,600 worse off as a result of the Chancellor's statement yesterday. So what do we need? We need to face the facts. The current system discriminates and fails women time and again. Whether they are parents, carers, have a disability, or are victims of domestic violence, have a long-term condition, are a refugee, or have other cultural barriers, the system fails them. A future social security system for Scotland needs to have security at its heart. In order to get Britain working, we have to get Britain's women working, and that won't happen under this system.
Many thanks. I now call Margaret McDougall, to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you. I was a member of the Welfare Reform Committee when evidence was being taken on this topic in June, and during the evidence sessions we learned that inequality for women still exists within our society, and that the recent welfare reforms have increased this inequality because women are disproportionately affected by the welfare reforms. A recent report produced by Engender found that women are twice as dependent on social security as men, with 20% of women's income coming from the benefits and the tax credit system, compared to 10% of men's. The committee heard evidence that tax credits provide essential support for women who work, and I had real fears that the tax credit reforms would add to the pressure on women. So while I'm delighted with George Osborne's U-turn on tax credits, there is no doubt that the £12 billion cuts of welfare, which are still to come, will have an adverse effect on women and families over the coming years. The report found that 92% of lone parents are women, and women make up 95% of lone parents dependent on income support. During the committee stages, I highlighted the shocking statistic from Inclusion Scotland that at the time of giving evidence, sanctions for lone parents on JSA had risen from under 200 per month prior to 2008 to 4,700 per month. While I'd like to say this has fallen, I'm afraid that it hasn't, given Tory ministers seem to be in denial over the damage they're causing, especially to women and families across the country. So I agree with the committee's recommendations in calling for a complete and comprehensive overview of the sanctions regime. It's clear to me that sanctions are not encouraging people to find work. Rather, they seem to be demoralising people. The committee also found that many people don't even understand why they're sanctioned. You can't promote a change in behaviour if a person doesn't know what they did wrong or feels that they have been wrongly penalised. For example, during evidence, we heard the story of a lone parent, mother of three, who went to sign on during the summer school holidays. She was sanctioned because she had to bring her children to her interview as she couldn't get childcare. The job centre officer said if she didn't have childcare, this meant she wasn't available for work. In examples like this, can anyone honestly say sanctioning this mother of three was the right thing to do? This is a case where sanctions, in my view, have been wrongly applied. It might have been more helpful for job centre staff to assist this mother to find flexible and affordable childcare, rather than placing her and her children into further hardship and distress. The above example leads me on to my next point, the importance of flexible and affordable childcare, and the barriers that a lack of childcare can present. Close the Gap had argued that childcare can be prohibitively expensive, and this is one of the most immediate barriers for women returning to work. This is worse if you are on low pay, part-time hours, or a zero-hours contract, as you might not know how much you'll get paid that week or even when you need childcare, but you still have to pay to keep the child place open. Provision of childcare is also a major issue. The Family and Childcare Trust report into the annual Childcare Costs Survey 2015 tells us that in Scotland in 2014, Only 23% of local authorities reported sufficient childcare provision for parents who work full-time. But in 2015, this had fallen to 15%. For those with a disabled child, in 2014, the figure was 18%. This had fallen dramatically to 7% in 2015. Finally, for those in flexible working hours, these figures were even worse in 2014. Only 9% of local authorities reported sufficient provision. And shockingly, this had fallen to 4% in 2015. I acknowledge the work that Scottish Government has done on access to childcare and provision, but from the statistics, we can see that not enough is being done to support it across our local authorities, and it's getting worse. It's good that we have childcare places for all 3 to 4 year olds for up to 600 hours per year. It's not so good that these places aren't available in reality. This was further emphasised by One Parent Families Scotland, who said in evidence that lone parents are trapped. When children are under 5 and their parents want to access training and education, it's a challenge for them to get childcare. When the child reaches 5, the doors to access training, education and higher education are closed because the parent has to be available to work and sign on. It's clear that if we want to develop a transformational childcare policy, we need to do more to tackle the lack of places and the lack of flexible, affordable, wraparound childcare. This is one barrier we know we can break down, and we need to redouble our efforts to do so. To conclude, Presiding Officer, with the further social security powers coming to this Parliament, it's clear that we can do things differently to improve the situation for women here in Scotland. And I welcome that the Minister said today that this will be given consideration and that dignity and respect will be at the centre of Scotland's social security system. On childcare, we have the power now. We just need the political will to create a fully transformable childcare system that works for everyone who needs it. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to give members fair warning. If you go over 6 minutes, I'll now have to cut you off. John Mason to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, for the opportunity to speak. And can I also thank the committee for what I felt, as an outsider to the committee, a very wide-ranging and thorough report. It's good that we are to have new welfare powers devolved to Scotland, but of course the powers are only part of the answer or part of the question. And currently I have a couple of questions, main questions, which are, can we do better with the existing money which we have or going to have, but also do we need more money to create a better system? From what I can see in the report, we could do better with the existing money and recommendations like moving away from monthly to a single household, from monthly payments and from single household payments, it would be positive, and in some cases making rent payments direct to the landlord would be positive. Looking at the report itself, I thought paragraph 49 was very telling in some of the quotes it had and under the universal credit section, and struck a chord with me and I think with some of my constituents. It deals with the whole point about monthly payments. It was recognised that this is not the lived reality for many benefit claimants whose lives are not so ordered. It could give rise to problems with budgeting, being cash rich at the start of the month. And then it quotes Morag Gillespie of Glasgow Caledonian University, who said, on the one hand, we are looking for people to live on quite a hand-to-mouth basis. Lots of people still get paid and live from week to week or fortnight to fortnight, while on the other, we almost want to pretend that they are white-collar workers with monthly salaries. Lots of people's lives are not quite that tidy, and we need to accommodate the differences. I think that phrase, accommodating the differences, is something that the committee and I certainly desire, but we don't see very much of that in the DWP. Clearly, there can be a real disconnect between the reality which many ordinary folk live and the theoretical existences imagined for them by some of the mandarins at Westminster. Now, there are particular issues that I'd like to touch on in the report, and the main one would be sanctions. I have been certainly concerned about these for some considerable time and have always felt that while bedroom tax would perhaps reduce people's income, and again unjustifiably, sanctions can actually completely remove people's income. And I just feel that's so much worse. Paragraph 80 talks about the committee, one of the conclusion paragraphs, had previously reported an impact of sanctions It continues to urge the DWP to review how its policies are being applied, and I can broadly agree with that paragraph. However, I did have some questions about the preceding paragraph in paragraph 78, where it said the committee had always agreed that some kind of conditionality is important. Now, surely we have to accept that every single person, be that in the UK or Scotland, deserves food and shelter as the absolute minimum. After all, we accept that prisoners are entitled to that, and that is not conditional. So surely everybody else should get at least that. So for me, that means there needs to be a certain minimum income, which every individual and every family should get, which is completely unconditional, no matter what they do or what they do not do. I think this was the point that Engender was making in one of their list of recommendations when they talk about citizens' income, and that is something I think we need to think about going forward. Employment is another topic which gets mentioned in the report, and paragraph 14 notes that the aim of universal credit was intended to encourage everyone to gain and sustain employment. But I would agree with those who argue that employment is not the right course for everyone. Like it or not, as has been mentioned in previous speeches, a number of women are often still the main carers, both for the older generation and the younger generation and others, as Christina McKelvey referred to. And we as a society benefit from these carers doing that key role. So we as a society in turn need to accept that there are some people we should be supporting in the long term if necessary, and they should not be having to seek employment, even though technically they might be able to do so. I'm happy also with the suggestion that we move more to using the term social security rather than welfare. Another subject, universal credit. Clearly things have moved on since the report was written, and we certainly do welcome the relaxation of the proposed cuts. However, if the same overall savings are to be made within the welfare budget, there have to be concerns about where that will hit. Devolution of powers is a key element going forward, and the fiscal framework has been mentioned and is meant to ensure fairness and no detriment to Westminster or Scotland as a result of powers being devolved. But I have to say I remain sceptical about this, and the signs we have seen so far have not been good. The original theory was that whichever Parliament made changes, that Parliament would incur the subsequent costs. However, with the tax powers we've got so far, we see that Westminster made the changes, but this Parliament had to write the cheque for all the costs. So the precedents are not good, and it concerns me about welfare as well. Whatever powers we end up with, we will still face a limited budget if we want to have a more generous welfare system, especially for women. And the question then is, where will the money come from? The obvious options are to reduce spending in some other area or to perhaps to raise taxes. Now, we're being more consensual today because it's a committee report, and I support that. However, we will have real choices to make as we go through the budget process, and I think that is going to be challenging. And I would call on all parties to be realistic that if they want more money in one place, they have to tell us where it comes from. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. I now call Willie Coffey to be followed by Ken McIntosh.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. The Welfare Reform Committee's report on women and social security is surely one of the most important reports produced by the Parliament in this current session. It's a substantial piece of work highlighting the impact of welfare reforms on women and putting on record, possibly for the first time in the one document, how many of these changes have served to aggravate existing inequalities that women experience. Numerous examples within the report illustrate these inequalities across a whole spectrum of welfare reforms, from universal credits, the sanctions regime, the impact on women carers and single parents. The report shows how women are affected in particular as a result of the welfare reform agenda. One of the most startling figures that has been mentioned by several members that has come to light from the House of Commons Library was that since the reforms began in 2010, some £26 billion worth of cuts have been made, and a staggering £22 billion of that was taken from women's income. The committee has made a large number of recommendations for both the Scottish and the UK governments to consider, and I'm pleased to read the detailed comments from the Scottish Government indicating that work is already underway to bring about the changes requested. I'm not aware if the UK Government has responded to the report as yet. So I think we should pay tribute to the committee, past and present, to all those who gave evidence and to the clerks in putting the report together. Some concerns were raised about universal credit, of course, and the system of single monthly payments, and the issue about a person in the household, usually the male, being the recipient of the payments, including those intended to cover things like rent. The worry is that this makes it much more difficult for a woman to negotiate and manage the household income in terms of family priorities. The Scottish Government's response supports a move to twice monthly payments and for direct payments to landlords that would remove some of the concerns here. People will have a choice of how they want to manage their account, giving them more control over their own affairs. In addition, women are far more likely to earn less than their male partners and therefore be regarded as the second earner. Professor Diane Elson commented that when earnings disregards and tapers were taken into account, it's not financially worthwhile for many women to take on a job at all. And so the committee has asked the UK government to re-examine the allowances for second earners to overcome this problem, which greatly affects the ability of women to enter the labour market. One area that the committee heard about the severe negative impact, particularly on women, was in relation to sanctions. One of the most common problems is when appointments were delayed or cancelled by job centres, and women in particular have been unable to attend and rescheduled dates due to childcare issues or affordability of transport costs for those repeat journeys as a result. The Scottish Women's Convention noted the hypocrisy of the DWP themselves making errors and causing delays, having no impact, yet when a person makes a mistake, then it usually leads to a sanction being imposed. Sanctions and delays in benefit payments are one of the main causes of people being driven to food banks in order to survive. And I've seen countless constituents in Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley coming to food banks, citing both those reasons as being the main factor. The effectiveness of sanctions has also been questioned. Howard Reid from Landman Economics told the committee there was no relationship between sanctions and employment levels. Areas where sanctions had been employed with greater gusto, as he described, actually showed employment rates were actually slightly lower. He also informed the committee that there is no UK government data looking at the impact that sanctions have on people and their families as a whole. So the committee therefore called on the UK government to conduct an independent review of the sanctions process to establish the impact they are having, whether they actually help people into work or not, and to revise the appeals process so that it can be carried out much quicker. One of the biggest barriers for women in taking up employment is finding suitable and affordable childcare. Carers Scotland said that women are four times as likely as men to have given up work because of multiple caring duties, and that 85% of people who care for children and an adult, called sandwich carers sometimes, are also women. As members know, the Scottish Government will double the childcare provision to about 30 hours per week, on a flexible basis too, by the end of the next Parliament. Bernardo's comment that the flexibility and wraparound nature of this is just as important as the provision of the funding itself. So this should have a hugely positive impact, presiding officer, on the ability of women, and men too, it has to be said, to get into work and still maintain their family duties and obligations. Lastly, in my contribution from the report, presiding officer, just a word in support of lone parent women. We note in the report that 92% of single parents are women, and that means we have over 150,000 single parent women in Scotland. There are supposed to be safeguards, 12 safeguards in fact, that the DWP should apply to protect lone parents from having their circumstances worsened. But we heard from the Single Parent Action Network, who noted that only a quarter of those had agreements with their local job centres allowing them to restrict their job searches to school hours, one of the 12 safeguards that are particularly important for women. Presiding officer, the impact of the Welfare Reform Act on women in Scotland is particularly unfair. I know the Scottish Government is working to mitigate much of this as far as we can, spending some £300 million already and undoing the damage that would have been done to thousands of women in Scotland had we not acted. But it's not all about money. It's about restoring a sense of fairness, dignity and respect at the heart of a system that values its citizens and offers genuine equality for Scotland's women. Hopefully the new Scottish Social Security system will begin to put that framework in place. And I once again commend the work of the committee in bringing this report to the Parliament.
Thank you very much. I now call Ken McIntosh to be followed by Christian Allard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I begin by thanking all the members of the committee for their work on this report. I think we all know that the recession in particular has had a devastating effect on Scotland across the whole of the UK, but it's particularly affected certain groups. It's affected the young, affected disabled people, and it's affected women, affected their prosperity and their sense of well-being. And at that difficult time, our welfare system, instead of offering relief and support to women across Scotland, the welfare reforms has made that situation more stressful. It has disproportionately failed vulnerable people, and it's disproportionately failed women in our society. And I think that the committee has done, the Welfare Reform Committee has done a fantastic job in illuminating the failings of the system in many ways. The report on sanctions, for example, pointed out that it's led to a climate of fear rather than encouraging people back into work. The report on food banks revealed the direct correlation between food banks and the welfare reform programme. And of course, on the bedroom tax, it was the research from the committee that illuminated the fact that some 80% of those affected by the bedroom tax, the households affected, contained a disabled adult. But this particular report is very much continuing in that very powerful vein. And I have to say, I was struck by some of the statistics in it, and I think they're worth repeating. Some colleagues have already mentioned this, but since 2010, some £26 billion worth of cuts have been made to benefits, tax credits, pay and pensions, and 85% of this £26 billion has been taken from women's incomes. That's a staggeringly disproportional impact on women. And the committee went on to quote figures from Engender, from Close the Gap and many others, revealing that women are twice as dependent on the social security system as men, they have fewer financial assets, and that they're far more likely to be lone parents and carers. Now, I think it's right that we make common cause across this Parliament on this issue. Austerity and the welfare reform programme are bad for our economy, they're bad in terms of prosperity to individuals and to our communities. This is not, frankly, the kind of society that many of us wish to see. We want to see an end to punitive sanctions, to discrimination and to blaming people in need for their own misfortune. But I hope that this afternoon we will do more than that. If all we do is blame the Conservatives and the UK government, then we're not facing up to our own responsibilities, nor are we using the powers that are at our disposal for the purpose I believe they were intended. And like many members here, I know I lived through the Thatcher years, and I was frustrated by the fact that here in Scotland, you know, we would elect representatives of one particular party and a different hue in another part of the UK. But the answer to that is this Scottish Parliament. And it is very difficult to imagine the poll tax being introduced now with the Scottish Parliament here. And the committee's own work has revealed that the UK government cannot impose reforms on this country without without us being powerless to do anything about it. And the bedroom tax in particular has revealed that. And in fact, by acting on the bedroom tax, the Welfare Committee analysis showed that that had particularly, our mitigation of the bedroom tax, had particularly benefited women in Scotland. Now, I want to give a couple of examples in particular for me in the time. I particularly want to mention Motability. I don't know if members have recently received a letter from Motability, because clearly there are changes underway at the moment and there's a transition scheme in place. Motability, as most of people here will know, is a scheme which allows disabled people to access or to lease a new car, a scooter or a powered wheelchair by exchanging their government funded Motability allowance. And you qualify if you get the higher mobility payment under DLA or the new enhanced rate under PIP. Now, I made some inquiries of this, and I discovered there are 519 people using Motability in my own constituency of Eastwood, 1,700 across the whole of East Renfrewshire. So I was asking how many are expected to lose their allowance. Now, they can't say exactly, but they said that so far, some 12,000 of the people being reassessed, some 12,300 to be exact, have been awarded the same level of support and have retained membership of the scheme, but 9,000 have lost eligibility. Now, that's almost 40%. Now, that is a huge number of people losing out on their Motability allowance. And I think the Disability News Service has pointed out that more than 100 people a week are losing their Motability vehicles because of the change from DLA to PIP. And one of the parts of the committee's report that I found most striking was the impact this is having on disabled women. According to Close the Gap, disabled women are particularly affected by social security reforms because disabled women are far less likely to be in full-time employment than non-disabled people. The employment rate for disabled men, for example, is almost 90% compared with only 40% for disabled women. And Inclusion Scotland evidence, the committee said that in Scotland, over 55% of those in receipt of the high rate mobility, in other words, qualifying for a motability car, are women. And they concluded that, as a result, women are far more likely to lose out. Now, why does that matter? Well, I think we all know that, you know, if the point of the welfare reforms is to gain access to work, the whole point of motability is to allow access to work, access to childcare.
You need to draw to a close.
Instead of helping people into work, we are going to hurt women. And I would ask the Scottish Government, there wasn't much in their response on this particular point other than you're working with motability. So I would ask you to, Minister, if you can, expand on that. In particular,
you must close, please.
Whether you look at the concessionary travel scheme, which currently does not apply to the high rate, but only to the low rate, but only to the high rate.
Many thanks. Christian Allard, I'm afraid I can only give you 5 minutes now. Sorry.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I've got enough for 20 minutes, but I'll do only 5 minutes. And thanks to Ken McIntosh, I think he strikes the right tone when he said that the poll tax, the bedroom tax, will never be introduced in this Parliament. We are in a different place here in Scotland. And that brings me to Baroness Goldie, who is closing down for the Conservative. Presiding Officer, we have a Doctor Who in the room, somebody who every week, or every such and such, time travel and goes from this Parliament, Scotland, 21st century, modern Scotland, down to Westminster. And she's going back at least once or, you know, one or two century at least back, maybe 3 centuries for the House of Lords. So maybe Baroness Goldie could maybe enlighten us and tell us how, for example, as a member of the Equal Opportunities Committee, she can explain why her own party at Westminster is targeting the poorest of the poor. And I'm not going to give credit to Mr. Osborne. I think a lot of members this afternoon give a lot of credit to Mr. Osborne by thinking that Mr. Osborne somehow is targeting women. He's not. He couldn't care less if they're women or if they're men. What he cares about is targeting the poor. So maybe Ms. Goldie, Baroness Goldie, could maybe tell us, you know, how that will is going to do for equal opportunities here in Scotland and across the UK. If you target the poorest in society, and as we know, most of the poorest in society are women, not only this, but the aggravating factor is that the poorest of the poorest in our society are women. How can she explain that? How can she not go and speak at Westminster to whoever she needs to speak to who will hear her, to say that having this kind of welfare cuts targeting the poor will stop any kind of progress to equality between men and women in Scotland? And I'll even say further than this. I think this Scottish Government, this Scottish Parliament, as much effort that we do to try to narrow the gap with what's happening at Westminster and both the House of Lords and the House of Commons, what's happening in this place 2 centuries or 3 centuries ago, only a night travel, of course, what's happening down there is really affecting what we do here. That we will maybe only manage to keep the gap the way it is. Because let's not forget all the effort that the Scottish Government do or the Scottish Parliament does, and we do a lot of effort, and we heard about it, and I thank the committee to pinpoint a lot of it, will be changed by that. And let's quantify this. In this report, and I read a lot of reports on the matter, one of the truth was said by the joint report from Engender, Scottish Refugee Council, Scottish Women's Aid, Close the Gap, and Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisation. And that report was used to do this report. And what they reminded us is women did not enjoy equality with men in Scotland before welfare reform. They didn't, and they don't. So it's how to narrow that gap. And I talked a lot about that, about when we did our report on equal opportunities of women at work. I think we need to go a lot further than this. We need to talk about men at home. And when I mean about men at home, I'm talking about Of course, social security is what it's all about. It's about how do we help the people who care for the children at home? How we can make sure that the carers, that people who are not full at work or at low pay, who are only a part-time, who have this, you know, enormous 0 hours contract, which are incredible. How can we help these people just to make sure that we can have a gender balance? And we'll never have a gender balance if we don't do that, if we don't sort out this problem. And one thing I would just say, Presiding Officer, is about the language. I want to congratulate the Scottish Government and the Committee for the Language, because we shouldn't talk about welfare, but we should talk about social security. Just the same way that we should not talk about benefits or allowance, we should talk about entitlement. It's very important that we change our language when we talk about it. Maybe more important than ever, let's talk about parenting as opposed to do a gender difference. Thank you, President.
Many thanks. We now turn to the closing speeches. I call on Annabel Goldie. Maximum 6 minutes, please, Ms Goldie.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I say, I think this has been an interesting debate, and I think there have been genuinely some very thoughtful contributions. Let me respond to Monsieur Allard, who raised an important point, because it is a point about political debate. And I would say to Monsieur Allard, in response to his question, that my party in government has had to deal with an economic challenge. It has had to deal, and this is what's interesting, what I don't think anyone has disputed was a need to reform the welfare system, and that's what I find fascinating. I hear a lot of criticism of what my party has done in government. That's perhaps predictable. I hear very little about what my political opponents would offer by way of substitute, but maybe we will get more of that as time proceeds. Can I say, Deputy Presiding Officer, forgive me, I really need to make progress, that by way of context for all of this, of course, in Scotland since 2010, we have got over 170,000 more people in jobs. We have got over 2 million people getting more of their pay at the end of the week back because of tax cuts, and I don't hear Mr. Allard referring to that. I thought my colleague John Lamont, in his speech, very usefully placed some of the changes to social security in context, outlining a number of the lessons to be taken forward in the committee's current work, because this is undoubtedly an important period in the timeline of the social security system or welfare state in Scotland. And yes, we have seen extensive reforms at UK level, but interestingly, from my perspective, there is now a real impetus for this Parliament to consider our own approach to social security, and not least the position of women within that. The committee report, and I did serve in the committee during the time of this inquiry, I thought it produced a number of very important findings, conclusions and recommendations. And yes, it is the case that I dissented from some of these, where either they were in conflict with my party's policy — I think in Scotland we're still allowed to have political disagreements — or I disagreed with the analysis. But the inquiry and report did make some important comment on aspects of universal credit. I thought paragraph 13, where I indicated a dissent, the Chamber might be pleased to hear, I am repented, I have changed my mind, and I think there is a need for greater flexibility. I think that would be desirable. On sanctions, again, I thought paragraphs 16 and 17 are very powerful. I did manage to clarify, despite what one or two committee members were indicating, that I understand no political party supports the principle of abolition of conditionality. I understand the SNP currently supports a moratorium in applying it. But, you know, if you believe in the principle of a system and you're not in agreement with how it's being implemented, you have to come up with your own suggestions as to how you think it should be done better. Having said that, Deputy Presiding Officer, I do think sanctions is a very important area. I do think more information and better information needs to be provided to claimants. And I entirely agree that it is completely unacceptable where there has been genuine oversight or an unavoidable absence to attend a meeting, perhaps to a carer's responsibility or obligation. I do think it's unacceptable a sanction should be imposed in these circumstances. And of course, the report also contains very constructive comments across a whole range of issues, including employment and job-seeking support, carers, lone parents, women who are vulnerable for a variety of reasons, and of course, the need to have a stronger link between the social security system and GRFEC. Now, we have an important range of powers coming to this Parliament as a result of the Smith Agreement, and I was privileged to be part of that. And what's encouraging me, Deputy Presiding Officer, is we're starting to see movement towards policy from the Scottish Government on these matters. There is one area where we have detail, and this may stun the Minister. I especially commend the Scottish Government for its approach in this respect. Almost three quarters of those in receipt of carers' allowance are women, and these individuals are a vital part of our society, estimated to be saving the NHS and social care services billions of pounds as a result of their fantastic work. And Joe McAlpin spoke very eloquently about this. So I welcome the First Minister's statement that she'll support raising carers' allowance to the level of job seekers' allowance, giving a real boost to these extremely hard-working people. Indeed, I welcome that policy when my own party leader, Ruth Davidson, proposed it just a fortnight earlier than that at my party's conference. Can I just say briefly about women in employment, Deputy Presiding Officer, because it is worrying that over the past quarter we've seen a decline in that employment rate in Scotland, and the trend is the opposite direction across the UK as a whole. Now, while that trend has only recently emerged, I think we should all be concerned about its potential to grow into a longer-term issue, and I hope the Minister will be able to address this and both give the Scottish Government analysis for that trend and also set out proposals to address it. Now, as others have indicated, I too welcome the Chancellor's announcement on tax credits. Yesterday, I did have concerns, Deputy Presiding Officer. I was public about these concerns, and I did write to the Chancellor expressing them. So I'm pleased that that decision has been made. I thought the committee's conclusions on tax credits were balanced, but it rightly identified issues, and I hope these issues can be addressed as tax credits are brought into the structure of universal credit. In conclusion, I think we find that for the first time in the history of this Parliament, our debates on social security are now moving on from simply offering a view in the decisions of the UK government. And importantly, that was recognised by some contributors, not least John Mason, Willie Coffey and Ken McIntosh. And this is important. These things matter. So I may not have agreed with every conclusion in the committee's report, but it is still a substantial body of work and a very useful step in ensuring we have a Scottish welfare system.
Thank you very much, Colin Neil Findlay. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Before I begin, I have to mention Mr Allard, who was speaking about someone from another parliament time-travelling here and ending up in this one. And I have to commend him on his impeccable timing, because just as he said that, James T. Kirk himself walked into the chamber following, of course, the unveiling of his new, very regal portrait, I'm sure.
Mr Findlay, we try to avoid nicknames in the chamber, please.
I'm sure S&P members will be will be buying their copy for above their fireplace for Christmas. Presiding Officer, the committee report was written before I became a member of the Welfare Committee. However, I would like to commend the committee on it and concur with the views expressed in it, especially in relation to the way in which welfare cuts have affected women. Many members, quite rightly, Michael McMahon, Joe McAlpin, Ken McIntosh and others, have commented on the shocking statistics around these so-called reforms, and they're right to do so, because women are bearing the brunt of Tory government's all-out attack on working people. People have mentioned 85% of Osborne's social security cuts affecting women's incomes, and that engendered report, I think, which was so important and contributed a great deal to this debate, makes grim reading, showing women twice as dependent than men on tax credits and benefits. Women in the lowest paid, most insecure work, often part-time, often 0 hours, much more likely to be carers, having their hours cut to give up work altogether to take up that role, particularly at a time when the pressures on household budgets rise. And, of course, all the time, the gender pay gap showing little sign of closing. I've said for some time that Osborne and Cameron are engaged in a class war, but from this report it also is crystal clear that it's a gender war too. And their so-called reforms promotes the idea that the benefits budget, the funds for public services, the country's debt, are all the fault of the poor, the disabled, the unemployed, the low-paid and single parents. And several people have mentioned single parents. 92% of them women are quite startling statistics.
Annabel Goldie.
I hear what he says, but would he not acknowledge that in Scotland, where apparently we have more women in employment than we've ever had before, that that's actually very positive progress?
No, Finlay.
Of course, we would all welcome women getting into work, anyone getting into work, but if that work is typified by low-pay, zero-hours contract, then that is hardly a basis on which to build security for you and your family. And that is the problem with the jobs that are coming in Scotland. And I welcome the U-turn on tax credits. I even welcome Ms Goldie's U-turn on tax credits. She was there a couple of weeks ago in the House of Lords voting to abolish them. Now she's repentant, and I welcome the repentant sinner today. The fact that these tax credits are going back is a good thing. Irrespective of who takes the credit for it, it is a good thing because it's money going back into the pockets of working people. And of course, the whole agenda around the social security system sees the media enthusiastically embrace the negative view of a system buoyed by horrendous programmes like Benefits Street and screaming tabloid headlines about the evils of single parents. I find all of that utterly disgusting because, according to the DWP's own figures, the reality is that just 2% of the entire welfare budget is spent on unemployment benefits and 18% on family benefits such as tax credits. But 42% is spent on pensions. But, of course, facts like that don't fit into the prevailing narrative. So it's against that backdrop and the backdrop of more cuts coming, another £12 billion announced yesterday, and that frenzied sort of negative atmosphere around the whole system, that we are challenged with designing the social security system of the future. And I think the first and foremost and central principle that I would support is that we need a humane system that treats people with dignity and respect, and assists them to make that full contribution to our society that we all want to see. That has been a constant theme of the failings of the social security system. We heard from women a few weeks ago who told us about the lack of understanding of their situation, whether it be a mental health condition, a caring responsibility or a training need. And they also spoke of the failure of the work programme to recognise the value of self-help and voluntary work. The reality is the main problem for women, women and men, young and old, is the lack of good quality, full-time, permanent jobs in the economy, rather than any issues around employability. We heard from people who appear to be more often than not hindered by the system than helped by it, of a culture of benefits and employability that seems to lack empathy and understanding. This is not a criticism of the people who work in the system who are under huge pressure, but the culture that is led from number 10 and 11 Downing Street and permeates down to the front line. On a whole range of other issues, presiding officer, such as the impact on carers, the cared for, women fleeing violence, refugees, those with mental health issues and the effect on children, I share the committee's concerns. We have the opportunity to address these issues with the new welfare powers, and we should take that opportunity.
Many thanks. And to now call in Margaret Burgess. Maximum 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Okay. Presiding officer, I think this has been a useful debate and there have been excellent contributions from across the chamber, and I'll touch on them shortly and respond to some of them. But again, I want to thank the committee and the organisations that contributed to this report, which has helped us all understand how people really feel about the current welfare system and how it treats them. And I would also pay tribute to the work that Michael McMahon has done on this report at the start and in previous reports in the committee. He was there at the set-up of the Welfare Reform Committee, and the committee's produced a number of useful reports that certainly have helped inform government in how we take things forward. And as I said earlier in my opening remarks, this government is absolutely committed to removing some of the barriers that women face. We are already taking forward a number of actions to support these goals, but we are faced with the reality of our budget being cut by a UK government taking a wholly different ideological approach to the one that we want to take. And the news and tax credits yesterday, as I said earlier, it was welcome, but as the Poverty Alliance and the SCVO have pointed out, there will still be, and many members today have pointed out, there will still be some £12 billion taken from the pockets of some of the poorest people in society, and many of those cuts will disproportionately affect women and children. And what's worse, it has the potential to impact on the progress that we have already made here in Scotland. Our 2015 annual report on child poverty strategy for Scotland showed that using the powers already devolved to the Scottish Parliament, we're making progress on some of the main drivers that cause child poverty. And progress is at a risk, though, from measures which will hit thousands of low-income working families. And Peter Kelly from the Poverty Alliance said yesterday that the announcement on tax credits is welcome, but families still remain under financial pressure. Families will still lose the family element of tax credit, and working age benefits remain frozen until the end of this Parliament. We are now at a stage where there is nothing to cut. We are hurting the most vulnerable in our society, and I entirely agree with his comments. But I'll now respond to some of the points made in the debate. Jenny Mara talked about a summit to look at women's issues in social security, and that's certainly something that we're happy to consider. There's been a range of discussions through the Fairer Scotland conversations that we've been holding throughout Scotland, including in gender, the Scottish Refugee Council and the Scottish Women's Convention. So that's certainly something that we're looking at, and as we progress, something that's certainly on our agenda. Michael McMahon talked about the equality impact assessment in women, and the Cabinet Secretary has already responded to that and said, yes, that is part of the equality impact assessment, in gender and also on maternity and pregnancy issues, and that will certainly be looked at as well in any system that we're putting together. A number of members talked about carers and welcomed what the Scottish Government is already doing for carers and in carers allowance, what we have proposed. And interesting that Anna McGoldie supports that here in Scotland. I just wish her party was supported throughout the UK, and we weren't in this position that we're having to do it with our depleting budget. A number of speakers spoke about sanctions, and I think there's no disagreement in what's been said in this chamber today in sanctions and the impact it's having. And I think Joan McAlpine expressed it very well, talking about the carers having been forced to go into work because of perhaps the person they're caring from losing their benefit, and the impact that has on that carer at a tremendously emotional and difficult time for a family to then be faced with losing the only income they have and sometimes being forced to food banks. And I think Joan McAlpine illustrated that very well. Margaret McDougall and Willie Coffey spoke about childcare, and both Margaret McDougall and Willie Coffey acknowledged what the Scottish Government's already doing in childcare, and we are working very hard with local authorities in our 600 hours that we have committed to childcare as we go forward, and increasing that as we go forward, and also about building the flexibility into it that we know is required. We're also in that vein committed to working with employers and employers' representative organisations to look at flexibility in the workplace, because we know that also will help women and get women back into work. Kevin Stewart talked about the UK government doing a cumulative impact assessment on the impact of all the welfare reforms and benefit cuts has had on women. And very like Kevin Stewart, I would like to see that as well, just exactly what that cumulative impact is. Ken McIntosh talked about motability, and we recognise absolutely the trust that people place in the motability scheme and what that vehicle, getting a motability car, how it actually gets them out, gets them alive, gets them to contribute into society, and the real concerns people have when PIP DLA is changing over to PIP. And the Scottish Government's position has been very clear. We asked for the rollout of PIP to be halted. We asked for the budget to remain the same, and that's why the fiscal framework has to be really important, and I think we all agreed with that earlier, that we need to get the fiscal framework right for Scotland. We don't want to see people in a worse-off position. There was a number of other contributions made about the sanctions, about the impact, I think Christian Allard as well, about women not being equal before the welfare reforms, and this has just increased the inequality of women in society. But I want to just say in closing moments some of the most meaningful action that the government has taken. We have a strong record in taking action to support women and families. We support a range of gender organisations to the tune of almost £900,000. More widely, our current and planned funding will result in an investment of around £296 million over the period 2013-14 to 15-16, and a significant part of that funding goes on helping to support women's groups. I indicated earlier some of the action we've already taken in our existing powers, the mitigation of the bedroom tax, the Scottish Welfare Fund, and in terms of community care grants, women get community care grants than men. Sorry, are you telling me to wind up, Presiding Officer?
I'm afraid to have to close. Your time is
okay.
Up, Minister.
Well, Presiding Officer, as I said before, this Scottish Government is fully committed to working cooperatively with stakeholders and members across the chamber so we can achieve a system that better suits women and the people of Scotland. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call on Hugh Henry to wind up the debate on behalf of the Welfare Reform Committee. Mr Henry, you have 9 minutes, which will take us to 5 p.m.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I join with Kevin Stewart and the Minister in thanking Michael McMahon for his sterling work as convener of the Welfare Reform Committee? He helped, I think, to shape the influence that committee has had over a long period of time. And I know that from the contributions that have been made that the members of the committee have valued his input to it. It's actually been a very good debate, but do you know, you would expect that. A lot of consensus, people agreeing with each other. And I don't mean this as a criticism, but much of what's been said echoed what Claire Adamson said in her opening contribution, in a sense reinforcing the points that she ably put forward, because it is quite stark what is happening to women in not just in Scotland but across the UK in the social security system. Do you know, it's really hard to understand the scale of it. We live in a country where we keep saying we take pride in 21st century Scotland, Britain, there is equality before the law. Women are now treated equally. There is no discrimination. Well, yeah, that's fine, but up to a point. When you start to look at the reality that Claire Adamson and other speakers articulated, then you see that actually there is still discrimination. We are not all equal in this country. You know, 85%, it's hard to get your head around the scale of it. 85% of welfare cuts since 2010 are to women's income. Do you know, if you were to pass a law that actually said you're going to introduce discrimination of that level, there would be howls of outrage. And yet, somehow, there is a complacency that the reality of the decisions that reflect an 85% of cuts being impacted on women are acceptable. It's frankly unacceptable. And I don't think that any decent society should tolerate that kind of discrimination. And yes, we are all equal before the law, and no doubt, in theory, the benefit system is supposed to treat women equally. But yet, as speaker after speaker pointed out, it's women that bear the burden of the childcare rearing. It's women that have got to take time off work to look after a child when the child is sick. It's women who, as a number of speakers said, have got to give up their employment often to go to look after children. It's women, certainly.
I thank the member to take an intervention. I just wanted to give a warning across the chamber. By saying it too often, that it's women who do the childcare, it's women who are having the low-paid job. It's women who have to go home to look after children with the sick. But we may be reinforcing a stereotype and maybe not encouraging men to do this.
Hugh Henry.
Well, it would be absurd if we saw that the reality is that women do that, not to mention it in case we reinforce it. Frankly, the more that we say it, the more that we challenge it. It's unacceptable. And being silent, hiding from it, is not going to change things. It's women who have to be the prime carer in many respects. You know, what is it? 74% of people on carers' allowance are women. 95% of lone parents on benefits are women. Lone parents are more likely to be sanctioned than other claimants. So Neil Findlay made a reference to this not just being a class war, but a gender war. Well, in a sense, there is some truth. I think the committee started off from a perspective of trying to look at social security from a gender perspective. But actually, you can come very quickly to the conclusion that it's actually a gender issue. It's women that are bearing the brunt of the cuts that are happening in the social security system, and that is just unacceptable. Now, the fact that so many members have repeated much of what Claire Adamson had been saying actually reflects the reality that they're finding in their constituency postbag. It reflects the reality of the casework. And Margaret Burgess is quite right to say that the Scottish Government should be committed to a family-friendly, flexible society. But, you know, as Jenny Mara had said, the claim that we are all in this together, the facts just belie it. It is just not true. We are not all in this together. Women are bearing the burden of childcare. Women are bearing the burden, yes, Christian Allard, of responsibility for care. And women are bearing the burden of the cuts to social security. Now, as Jenny Mara had suggested, one of the things that, I think the Scottish Government and the committee, hopefully the committee would back this, that the high-level summit to address the impact of the gender impact of cuts, the committee has made reference to the evidence that we have heard from a number of organisations talking about organisations coming to together. Now, Michael McMahon mentioned that women are disproportionately affected by welfare reform, but he also pointed out to the complexity often in women's lives, the complexity that speaker after speaker has mentioned. And, you know, he paid tribute to the contribution that Engender made and talked about multiple identities, carers, disabilities, looking after our children and so on. And yet, 51% of the workforce are female. Now, Alan Bell Goldie said, is it not something to be proud of, to congratulate that so many women are now back in the workforce? And as Neil Findlay said, yes, of course. But when women are coming into the workforce on minimum wage, when women are coming into the workforce in zero-hour contracts, when women are coming into the workforce with no security of long-term employment, when women are coming into the workforce that they are the ones most likely to be paid off whenever there is a problem, then there is something still to worry about. You know, it's not women coming into the workforce and rejoicing about the number of women that come in to the Scottish Parliament or go to Westminster into well-paid jobs with good pensions. It's worrying about the women in my constituency, in Linwood and in Barrhead and in Johnston and Neilson, who do not know from week to week what their income is likely to be or what the future is likely to hold for them. And saying to them, as I think a number of speakers did, and I think it was John Mason that made the point, saying to them that you need to go to work isn't necessarily the moral or right thing to do. Because some women still, yes, as we said, and I repeat time and time again, still have to look after the children, still have to look after someone with a disability. And to say to that person, who often is already on a low household income, that you need to go out and work and enjoy the dignity and the respect of work frankly, has been inhumane to that individual when you look at the circumstances that they are having to cope with in their household day in and day out. Frankly, we should be applauding them and encouraging them, and as John Mason and others said, actually supporting them for doing the job that otherwise would not be done in caring for those who often are ignored and overlooked. So there are double standards still in our country, and John Mason is right to say that we need to nail this issue about forcing people into employment. Now, you know, Willie Coffey again mentioned that women are more likely to have to give up work because of carers' duties, and he made the link between food banks and sanctions.
If you could conclude, Mr Henry.
Certainly, Presiding Officer. And that has come out time and time again. So Ken McIntosh made an interesting point about motability that I think needs to be explored further. But, you know, I'll finish with this point. It's all right moaning and groaning about how bad things are, but what I hope this Parliament and the Scottish Government will do is take what the committee has said to actually form the basis of a future that is totally different from the one that exists just now. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the Welfare Reform Committee's debate on women and social security. We now move to decision time. There is one question to be put as a result of today's business. The question is that motion number 14791, in the name of Hugh Henry, on women and social security be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time, and I now close this meeting.